Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to a fresh new episode of Missing Curfew. I'm Shane O'Brien with my boy, Scotty Upshaw Updog.
Yo, yo.
Our captain in the booth, Kevin Connolly.
What's up, guys?
And the man, the myth, the legend, the one-eyed bandit on the East Coast, Broadway Jimmy Hayes.
What's up, boys?
Hazy, we got to know what's going on with the eye patch real quick, bro. We were talking about on the car ride up. We're worried about you. You're looking good now. You got it off now, so you all good?
I got the eye patch off, but I got to go see a specialist on Thursday. I decided to read a book 2 weeks ago, a 400-page book, and, then the eye started to give out on you. So it's
just keep it to watching movies, Jimbo.
Yeah.
Fuck yeah, I'll never read a book again in my life.
Now, why would you start now? Anyways, moving right on to, we're all golfers here. We're going to move into the U.S. Open. First thing I want to touch base on, I saw on Kevin Connolly's Twitter, Cons, I got to talk to you about your setup. Listen, your golf setup, it looked good. Your knees were bent. Your head was up. Your shoulders were square. And listen, I'm not hating on you because I got the same problem. Mine's from sitting on the bench too much on the plane. Maybe yours is from being on set, director's chairs. You got to turn the shoulders and turn the hip, fella. If you don't turn that, you're going to get no power, Cons.
Listen, I posted it because it went in the cup. So I guess theoretically I do need to make that fix. But for that particular shot, I lined up the right way because it was in the cup.
Yeah, you know your captain's working hard when he's calling you not non-podcast related things and questions. He's asking about just, hey, Updog, how do I get more power on this fucking driver? I mean, I set up right.
You gotta get the hips through.
I'm like, Cons, you got to fucking tee it high, let her fly, buddy.
No, that's what he said, Broadway. He gave me a half hour lecture about my hips. I get it. I got to get the hips out in front of the ball. I'm working
the hips
on
don't
it.
Lie.
Hey, Shakira, Cons, the hips don't lie, buddy. Shakira.
That's it. I pulled the Kobe Bryant today. I was out at the track, 4:30, 5 o'clock, hitting balls in the dark before tee off, and I still fucking shot a shitty round, but whatever.
Hey, listen, that's golf. You're dedicated. I love it. And Broadway, we're going to touch on the U.S. Open real quick. Give us your thoughts. We know you had a member guest. Did you watch U.S. Open? What did you think about that Nerd Biscuit winning it?
Oh, man. First off, that guy's definitely on the juice, or he's just on a Big Mac diet, because this guy is a tank all of a sudden. He can absolutely stripe on Cons. He gets his hips through that ball.
Yeah, he does.
But, you know, when Tiger and Phil don't make the cut, I kind of lose interest a lot more quickly.
Yeah. We need to see those top dogs. You know, the old dogs too. Tiger and Phil, they fucking, you know, when you think of U.S. Open and majors, those guys coming down Sunday, those boys in the lead or somewhere there, it makes it all that more exciting. But fuck, tough watching Bryson DeChambeau fucking win.
I know.
I mean, I love a guy that hits it deep. But not a guy that's just drinking these fucking coconut waters and protein shakes.
Speaking of hitting it deep and drinking, tell us your Wingfoot story, Updog, because this is legendary. Uppy played Wingfoot Broadway. Tell us how you went.
Ooh, lucky
tell us your approach to Wingfoot, Updog.
Well, like normally, I showed up right to the first tee after an all-night bender in Philadelphia. Me and my boy Stewie's big friend of the pod.
I love Blaine.
Making our t-shirts for those
Blaine,
fans
we
out
love
there
you.
waiting for our swag. Stewie's the best golfer I know, probably +5 handicap. My boy from back home in Edmonton. And I had him in Philadelphia for a little boys trip back in fucking 08. And we went in for this Hockey in Harlem. You ever heard of that tournament, Jimmy?
Yeah.
Hockey in Harlem tournament. They played at Wingfoot. So we have this all-night bender in Philadelphia just chasing Philly babes all over, you know, all over Market Street. And we hum in the morning.
What were
we
those babes looking like?
We fuck. We'll hear about those babes later when we bring on our guests. So we hum in there and we get to play 36. I remember we played the first 18 with Manny Malhotra, who was at the time playing, I think, for the Rangers. And fucking this course was a beast. So getting to watch the big boys out there this weekend, the big trees, fucking small little dinner plate, little nipple greens they have out there. I mean, fuck, that's a disaster. You're spilling 90 with your fucking
I was gonna ask you that. I talked to Getzlav yesterday, and Getzy's a good stick, and I think you break 90. He said no chance. And our buddy Tom Doherty, who's a 4 handicap, says no way he breaks 100. But I said, with your TDs out there, which is straight tequila is what he drinks, I think he breaks 100.
Is it really that hard? I mean, Kevin Dillon's a 20-year member of Wingfoot. You're telling me it's that hard?
I mean, they had to buy extra property to push the tee boxes back at this track. So, I mean, they're bumping the boys back for 500-yard par fours. I just think that old school style of golf with the big trees and fucking getting the rough up in that U.S. Open, it's going to make things hard.
Did you see the picture of the rough? The guy put like a monster energy can in the rough and you couldn't even find the energy can. So imagine trying to find your ball hacking out of that shit.
What do you hit out of that? A low iron?
After I fluff it up for you, Cons, you hit a fucking five iron. But if I'm in your group, I'm like, Cons, you're too good a guy. I'll fluff that up.
You got to fluff that up. Let it ride at the top of the grass. Ball.
But it was craziness, and I love talking golf with you boys. But let's get into the bubble talk. We've talked a lot about the players sacrificing. And listen, guys, these guys are in the finals. They've been there for 2 months now. It's crazy. I want to touch on the trainers. I don't know if our listeners know how hard these guys work on a daily basis on a regular NHL season. In the bubble, it's nuts to me. So we want to touch on two guys that we loved, Frosty and Moods in Florida. They were unbelievable. Uppy, just touch on what they did for you in Florida and how hard these guys work, especially if they were stuck in a bubble.
Hold on, Uppy. Before you answer that, I have a question for the laymans out there, like myself. What exactly does the aside from the obvious, what does the equipment manager do, and what could be so great about these equipment managers and other, what do you rely on the equipment manager for?
For me, the equipment managers are guys on your team who do all the extra legwork and don't get the credit for it. They're guys who are up till, you know, 4 or 5 in the morning after road trips, unpacking gear on the plane, moving it into your room, airing it out. I mean, these guys are fucking digging through our bags, our wet skates, hanging
disgusting
our socks.
It's bags. Gross.
It's a gnarly job done for... You know, you picture an NHL season and 82 games and then into the playoffs. It's a consistent job. They're away from their families. They're away from their kids. You know, and then you think about the bubble. Obi's talking about the bubble here. They're only allowed to bring 52 employees, including players, coaches, medical staff. These guys don't have their extra hands. You know, at home games, Jimmy, you know, these guys have, you know, 2 or 3 young kids helping them out, filling water bottles, doing all this stuff. They don't have that anymore. It's tough. What do you think, Jimmy?
Yeah, I think you said it's the most underappreciated job in the NHL. And like you said, that was a great way to put it up. They're part of the team. They do all the dirty work, all the behind the scenes work. Everything goes unnoticed. And they're just guys that are continually there for players. They don't care who you are. If you're a rookie or you've been in the league for 15 years, they're going to take care of you no matter what.
Yeah, they're like the unsung heroes, Cons. And I'm just curious to you, what a guy on set, who does that for you? Who's the guy on set that's like, hey, helps you get through your day and does the little things to make sure you at your best performance?
Well, there's different parts to that job, but that's a loaded question. I like the analogy, but I think
they got the fluffers in the fuck.
I think the equipment manager is obviously different, but I mean, it's like he's a guy where you're never going to go and crack open your bag and you're going to be missing an elbow pad, right? Like everything is there. Set your watch by it. Whatever you need, it's going to be there.
Good thing Lupul had those trainers, eh? How many fucking times Lupul, did Lupul forget
oh my
his skates
God.
At some hockey?
Yeah, Cons, bro, we love it. So Loops.
How do you forget your skates?
I'll tell you how he does it. Loops lives on the beach, and he's going to come in next week, so we'll get him to tell a story. So we would have to drive from the beach to Anaheim Ice in Anaheim. It's like 45 minutes. 2 or 3 times a summer, this guy would come in, undo his bag, look down, be like, fuck, boys, forgot my wheels. And me and Uppy would lose our mind. Then we'd go out to skate, and there you see Lupul leaving the rink, carrying his bag. Fucking NHL All-Star carrying his bag.
So. No one would be more upset, too, eh? Because fucking Loops, he'd like to get out there and fucking snap it around.
He loved it. But
those are some of the best times.
I'm like, what'd you do? You couldn't skate? He's like, I just went and got a little workout, worked on my tan, so it wasn't a bad day. But
He used to leave his skates out on the beach because he would sweat like a motherfucker. So his skates would be just completely drenched if he left them inside. So he'd just leave them out in the sun, and then half the time he'd fucking forget them. Or if he did bring them in, they'd be full of fucking sand.
Well, the equipment managers get the day with the cup, so that says it right there. Yeah, they get their day. They earned it.
Let's just touch on Frosty and Moods. These two guys, I was up and down that year, Con, so I played about 10 games, but I was up 3 or 4 times, and besides Broadway and Upshaw and a couple of guys, I would go in there and see them right away, like give them a hug, tell them, just to explain how much these guys meant to you two guys in Florida that year, because they're two of the best to ever do it.
I would go sit in their room before every single game.
100%.
Just to shoot it with those guys, because it was just, they just make you laugh. They loosen you up for the game. They get you all dialed in. They get you all fired up. They had always had my Red Bull sitting right in my stall, ready for me to go. All my stuff was always perfectly packed, like perfectly set up on my stall. Just everything I needed right there in line. Frosty and Moods are one of a kind type trainers. And I got Frosty again in New Jersey.
Yeah, he's such a beauty, boys. I had him too in Nashville my very first year, both of them. So I had him since I was 18.
Wow.
You know, Frosty, you just got it. So Frosty, for example, Cons, Frost sent you a fucking hockey night in Canada.
I'm still waiting for
house.
It. Oh, you
it's
got
it? It's coming in. I forgot it. I had to use it. It was a big weekend. Jesus. So.
You might want to wash that, Cons, before you put it anywhere. Wash that,
if
baby.
It feels
who
if
knows what that towel
feels anything less than off the shelf. I'm not going anywhere near it.
Hey, so no, so Frosty, boys, he would always have like one of his buddies, such a well-liked guy. So you come in early. I met Bobby Orr in his fucking office one day. I went in just to have my coffee. That's where I met Bobby Orr. Totally. So he would always have one of his buddies from another team or just someone like he'd have fuck musicians, whoever. He was such a well-liked guy. And you go in and all of a sudden you're just like, oh, fuck. Frosty's like, come meet Bobby Orr. I'm like, awesome. Things like that, that these guys, year after year, they build relationships and, you know, they don't make a lot of money.
Well, that was going to be my question. Do they earn a decent living?
Boys, they don't make a lot of money, but what you learn as a young player from the older guys on your team is how to treat these trainers, how to take them, how to spend time. You take them for dinner, Con. So on the road, if you get a good night out, you invite them for dinner. A couple of the boys are going to a nice steakhouse, going to drink cons. Some nice vino.
Green lights.
Fucking
right.
Bring them out. Rookie parties, make sure they're on the bus. Things like that. You know, you get such good moments that these guys would love to share with you. And
What does Getzlaff tip the trainer? Not saying Getzlaff, but what is Kevin Hayes tipping the trainers?
My guess, Kevin Hayes is giving each equipment guy at least $5,000 to $10,000.
Wow,
that's National League. That's a National League tip.
That's big.
I'd be
ticket.
Shocked if he did not give them that. And then each milestone these guys hit, the guys appreciate them so much. That the team will chip in and buy him like a sick bottle of wine. I remember when Frosty, I think he hit like 1,500 games as an equipment manager, and we got him a big bottle of Opus One with a custom on it. And like, it was sick.
For my 500th game, he said 500?
500th?
500. 500, baby.
I'm hot today.
That's all right.
It's the second Coors Light I just cracked. It's fucking tasty.
You're looking good in that hat. That Action Park Media hat looks good on you, too, by the way.
So that my 500th game, boys, I played it in New York. Like, later on that season, in came a nice Magnum bottle engraved, like the fucking, it was St. Louis Blues versus New York Rangers, Madison Square Garden. Happy 500th game. Congrats, Frosty. Like, badass.
Your 500th game was at MSG?
Oh, yeah.
Did you tell me you stayed in New York after?
Oh, yeah, baby.
Oh, yeah. That's
Mac Daddy, the Mac Daddy took me out.
My 500th was on a back-to-back. I was playing four shifts with Hartley, so I'm glad you got the fuck out. I was just lucky. I'm like, this guy better not cut me before I get 500 for fuck's sakes around here. But
wouldn't you like to just smack that guy?
If I ever see that guy, I'm telling you. Bob Hartley, if I ever see him.
We could make a list of people you want to smack.
That's a whole other podcast.
But is he a player?
No, he was the only coach. Listen, I was in coaches' doghouses. So I get it.
You missed a couple curfews.
No, but Bob Hartley was a bad person. If you don't like me as a player, fine. But when you start judging my character as a guy, then we got issues. He's just a bad dude. But for the trainers out there, especially Frosty and Moods, we love you guys. And for fans out there, these trainers, they do a lot for NHL guys. So they make the league kind of run. But
honorary shout out to my boy Nasty too.
Nasty, I heard he's a beauty too.
Nasty, yep. Philly. Yeah, I'm sure.
Oh yeah.
Boys all got stories about Nasty.
Yo, Jimmy, Broadway, what do we got? I like your rumor mill better than I like Obes and Uppies for that matter. What do you got?
That's because he's still working out with all the boys. He's still fucking staying in shape. I got a juicy one.
Go ahead, what do you got?
I got some trade rumors that are about to fly. And it's going to start with one kid that I'm working out with, Ryan Donato. Say goodbye to Minnesota and all those tall, smoking blondes and get your ass to Nashville to get some country blondes, baby. And then I got Johnny Hockey. You can leave your Canadian phone in Calgary and get on a plane and get your ass to Philly and go play with my brother. Wow. And I think Borachek, you might have to get your Euro, Canadian, and American phone back, buddy.
Fuck, he looks like a Viking. Borachek would fit right up.
So that's just Calgary. A straight-up swap?
I'm hearing it's going to be Johnny Hockey and something else. I'm not sure what, to Philly for Voracek and Gothisbehere, but that's a lot of money for Calgary to be taking on. So there's going to have to be a juicy prospect coming from Philly too.
I think Philly needs to shake something up. And Calgary is another team that needs to shake something up too. They're underachieved this year. Both teams that were supposed to, were expected to do big things in the playoffs and just didn't. Are your boy over there?
I mean, I don't think Voracek's the fucking answer for Calgary, but... That's the trade. Is that the trade we're thinking?
That's the rumor I heard. Because Voracek's the only big dog with the no movement clause, so it's the only one that makes sense.
I think that's a good trade for Philly, and we'll get our boy Flowers' opinion on it. But I think that's a good trade for Philly.
Yeah, like I said, Philly, the city of Philly doesn't put up with them. Not, you know, when they have a good team and a great goalie, and they're expected to fucking run for that cup, and they don't. The shit hits the fan up in Philadelphia.
As we've seen.
And then there's another big rumor floating around right now with the first overall pick. the New York Rangers are supposedly sending the first pick to Ottawa for Brady Tkachuk in the third overall pick. Now, that is an absolute win for Brady Tkachuk.
And the third overall pick. Wow. Yes. Okay.
Listen, I would be shocked if that happened, but I like it.
Because Ottawa has three first-round picks, I think, coming up in this draft. I think they have three because of the Carlson deal. So that could maybe work.
Poor Lafreniere, you're going from fucking going out in One Oak and NYC after you score a hat trick in your first game to fucking Bucknuckville in Ottawa.
I bet she does better in Ottawa than he would do in New York, especially when he's young. Yeah.
I wonder if he can speak dirty French.
Hey, Broadway. So if you were gonna grade your rumors, where do you put that pick? The top, the middle, the bottom. How strong of a rumor is that?
We're just letting these rumors fly.
From my source, that I will not reveal.
Don't reveal your source, Broadway.
Please don't.
My source is never going to get revealed, but he's with somebody who's in contact with many GMs. So this rumor is, this thing's starting to heat up here, I think. And it's going to be first reported by Missing Curfew's project.
Yeah, that would be sweet.
So New York's thinking, you know, we can go from having a young McDavid to just being better right now, getting Brady Tkachuk, who's proven.
We're going to get Byfield at three.
Yes, okay.
That kid can skate. That kid's good.
Yeah.
Will Brady ever be what Matthew is in Calgary? Because if so, that's a legit pickup.
Big Wolf Tkachuk says Brady's tougher than Matthew. He said Brady would beat the shit out of Matthew.
If you can get Brady and that young kid, say his name again, Broadway, because I'm going to butcher it, the kid that plays in Sudbury.
Byfield?
Yeah, he can skate. He's a big kid. If you could get Brady, Tkachuk, and him, fuck, that's something to think about.
That's a win.
Does he wear bifocals like you got on right now?
No, these are Ricky Vaughn right here, baby.
You
got to
get the white tape on there
ball,
for
Ricky. Wild thing. Give him the ear.
Cons, I got a rumor. I'm not the insider like Broadway, but I got a rumor about your Islanders that I heard yesterday on NHL Network Radio with my boy Steve Kulis. Patrick Laine from the Winnipeg Jets. Lou Lamoriello is interested in him. I don't know what's going back, but what would you think about having a sniper like that on your Islanders?
Well, what's it cost us there?
Haven't heard, so I can do some more digging. But just in general, do you like having a guy that could stand on the top of the circle on your power play and fucking rip a cheddar?
Now, listen, I hope that's true, but isn't he one of those guys that kind of plays when he wants to play and then doesn't show up?
He takes some nights off, Con.
He takes nights off. I play every night. I hit golf balls at 5 a.m. until the sun comes up. I like a hard worker. He had a 50 a couple of years, didn't he?
I mean, he scored 40.
I think he had 50 1 year.
Maybe I'm making that up.
No, he hasn't hit 50 yet. Boys, I don't think he has.
He can shoot the puck better than anyone I've ever seen almost. He's had like 46, 30, and 30 or something like that, or close to that.
He went like 20 games one time without scoring a goal. Like,
is he
can't
a team
be a goal
guy?
Scorer and do that.
Team guy, Broadway? I wonder if he's a team guy. Because we play team hockey out there on the island.
From the sounds of it, no.
Yeah, that team, I don't know. I see that Winnipeg team being a little bit up in shambles with you know, the camaraderie there. I don't think they're all fucking flying to Vegas after the season's over.
They can't win because they got to live
in Winnipeg. They all went home 2 days later.
They got to live in Winnipeg, too, so that's
what's this Laine going to think when he's got to shave his fucking ugly beard for Lou Lamoriello if he gets there?
Yeah, that's true.
That thing was fucking ugly, boys. When he had that thing, he's hit with the all-ugly tree.
Yeah.
What's that lady from Game of Thrones? That's what he looks like.
The big one? Viking
chick? Jesus.
I actually think she's kind of hot.
Oh, God. You can find beauty in everybody.
How many Coors Lights?
Uppy had a few comments for Game of Thrones. I'm going to not even put on Missing Curfew, but they were fucking
my favorite show ever.
Listen,
how
about
this?
Do you
want him on your squad?
Yeah, I do. If he's going to put 40 up and Lou will come slap him right in his face if he's not playing team hockey. But, you got a guy like that. They got to put somebody with this Peugeot kid.
Trotsky, teach him how to play some D.
Yeah.
Trotsky will keep him in order.
Maybe Trotsky's what he just with the doctor ordered.
That's a great point by both of you. And my only concern when I watch that kid play, because I had these myself, he's got some slow boots. He's got some slow boots, and the game ain't getting any slower. It's not slowing down anytime soon. So that would be my only concern.
You guys say that
a lot.
You guys accuse everybody of having slow boots. That's just my opinion.
I had some fucking quick getaway sticks.
Hoppy can skate. Broadway can skate. I had slow boots.
I needed half the zone. If you could let me go blue line behind the net, get going, Yeah, that could skate.
I wasn't gonna
my getaway sticks, the first three steps weren't the fastest.
Broadway, that was always the worst thing when I looked at wingers being a winger when you gotta stop on the wall and then start up again. I'm like, oh, that's gotta suck.
Or pick one off the wall.
When
your D-man just rips.
I love coming down the wall on a winger when he's stopped and I'm like, this guy's got nowhere to go. I'm coming hard and I'm coming high at him too. So look out.
Oh, listen, being 6'5" with no knee bend, that's a tough way to get going.
If any of these rumors come through, I'll be impressed. There's a lot. Oh. There's a couple. Because also, too, those are big rumors, Broadway. Big ones.
Boy, Broadway, stir the pot up. I love it.
We're not going little on missing curfew. This isn't a little boy podcast. This is the big boys.
Okay, great job, Broadway, on the insider scoop. Let's move into some Stanley Cup playoffs. And the first thing I want to ask you guys as former players and cons, too, it's some fans put it into our message at missing curfew, and I kind of think about it, too. I never was in the Eastern Conference or Western Conference Finals, but the superstition of touching the trophy or not touching the trophy – does it matter moving in? What do you think it's stupid, or what would you do, Uppy, if you were in that situation?
I think it's fucking stupid because I'm not very superstitious. But you know, if there's a history on it, then you know you gotta kind of respect that. I don't think there is. I think you know, in 08, the Pittsburgh Penguins didn't touch it and they lose to Detroit. Next year, Crosby says fuck it, grabs it. Team fucking huddles around him. They go beat Detroit. I mean, so if Sid the Kid can do it, why can't anyone else do it?
But well, Sid the Kid can do a lot of things that nobody else can do.
He sure can.
That's right. True, cons. Fuck.
But listen, I'm with you, Uppy. I am kind of superstitious, and I still think at the end of the day, whether or not you touch that cup's got nothing to do with if you're going to win. Just kind of like if we're watching a football game at goal and you're not going to be able to, oh, but you can't freeze my field goal kicker from 3,000 miles away. You just can't do it.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. If there's a history behind it when you're not touching it, then yeah, I can understand that. But you know what? You guys just worked your ass off to win that trophy. If you want to hoist it up, hoist the damn thing up.
I mean, yeah, that's... Go ahead, Upsy.
Maybe not parade around with the fucking thing, but you can kind of touch it, maybe rub its balls a bit.
What about, what about if secretly we win the fucking Western Conference and no one sees us and then we take the trophy?
Of course that happens.
That happens? Does that happen?
Of course.
Because that's what I want to do.
Campbell, you're just
I'm like, okay, boys, we don't touch on the ice. We don't. But listen, we're going to Stanley Cup Finals. Fuck, we're playing Tampa. They're pretty good. Should we take this Western Conference out right now for a night to give us some mojo heading in the finals? You probably don't think like that. That's probably why I never won. But that could maybe happen.
I'm with you, though. Like what Broadway and Uppy said is you respect the tradition, right? So it's really more about tradition than it is about... Like, I don't, like, go running up and touching the Stanley Cup because traditionally I don't do that, right?
Yeah.
But it's not going to affect whether you win or lose.
And the only reason I said that about winning the Western Eastern Conference because if you do lose in the Stanley Cup Finals, you're not going to feel like partying with the Western Conference trophy then because you just lost the Stanley Cup. Or are you still going to be like, fuck, let's bring the Western Conference trophy? No.
I mean, look at baseball. Fair. These guys fucking rage every time they win.
That's true.
They win a wild card series.
They win the play-in game. They're like fucking champagne and everything.
It's like when Corona was over. Everyone's just fucking throwing bottles around. It's just, let's go.
Let's go.
Baseball's not allowed to celebrate this year because of Corona, I heard. No celebrating every division series this year, boy.
Yeah, that's for sure. I haven't watched. Fuck it. Let's
put some fans in the seats.
Every
sport
sucks.
No kidding. Let's get some fucking fans going.
Spread them out or something.
Like Jack. Like, geez. So let's move into game one and game two. I'm going to start the trend here. I'm going to sound like the old school guy. I'm going to talk about Tampa. Their power play, I think, was 0 for, I don't know, 11 or 12 or something. Or 0 for 7 heading in the first game. They take the two D-men off and put Kilhorn out there. He goes right to the fucking blue paint. He's in front of Hudobin, which opens up the seam for Kucherov over to your boy Palat, who buries in a wide open net. My point is, more of that from Tampa. Get to that blue paint, Broadway, and that's where good shit will happen.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Kilhorn was doing his job, causing all that havoc and getting in the mad Russian's eyes, and then you let your players like Kucherov and Palat make plays and just seam guys, and Palat just shoves it in the empty net.
I just love where this series is going physically.
Oh.
It's turned into a fucking man's fucking Stanley Cup final. You can see like the veteran presence of the Jamie Benns, the Perrys, you know, and then like fucking Luke Shen and the boys who want to play fucking rough hockey. They're playing for the cup, boys. In 2 weeks, if you didn't bring it physically in this thing, you know, you have a chance. You're not winning the fucking cup. You got to fucking play physical, play hard, try to beat this team out of the rink. And that's what I love seeing that out of Tampa game two. They really brought fucking physical energy because they got their asses kicked in game one. Dallas was ready to play. They weren't. So yeah, it's turned into a good physical series. I love it.
Well, so I don't know if yeah, there you go. Oh,
sounds of summer. Sounds
Irish
of summer.
Crickets. Irish crickets. I went to go. Looks like Obi polished off that bottle of wine, so I guess I had to go with the Coors Light.
There's a, I saved you a little bit in
all
here,
right,
but
that's all you. I got Irish crickets.
Little wine, little Canadips.
I knew I should have brought two. I didn't know if I. I didn't. My bad. But anyways, I was just gonna say about Jamie Benn real quick. I agree with you. Like this guy fucks. He's. You know what? I had this little argument between Flowers, actually, who we're going to hear from later, about Sagan and Ben. I know it's first world problems, but Jamie Benn, like you said, physically engaged. He hits Kucherov last night.
Kind of
great hit. Great
hit.
Fucking right. Hey, I didn't see it. I didn't see it, buddy. Keep your fucking head up. But what do you think, Broadway?
I agree with you. Like Jamie Benn is, he's been my favorite player to watch. I mean, you got these high-end guys that are making plays all night, but Jamie Benn, he's got, I think, 10 goals now or whatever he's got. What's he at, Jamie Benn?
His fucking playoff beard's nasty,
and
too.
He's just,
no
visor.
He just looks like an absolute player, and he's playing so hard. And, like, that first game, there was 106 hits. Like, this is the NHL Finals. This is unbelievable right now. These guys are putting it on the line and entertaining us.
It just feels like that C just looks good on his jersey.
Fuck, no visor. I love that.
Boys, have you guys ever seen a guy walk the blue line? And for fans out there, like walking the blue line means fucking being able to cradle the puck as a defenseman.
Open those hips.
Like
now, we don't know what that means. Explain that to us.
Okay, so the old 10 and 2. You know how you're taught to drive?
Oh, my hips can't do that.
10 and 2 on the steering wheel, right? Well, new age hockey, and I'm going to say new age, probably the last 7-8 years, you've seen players come in. Actually, Sidney Crosby was the first to do it. He came in the league. He used to play so low. His center of gravity would be so low to the ice. And then when we'd go get pucks to protect it, his feet would turn out. Like, his fucking toes would turn 10 and 2. And he could just cradle, like, protect the puck.
I feel
blah,
Barzell blah. Does that, a version of that.
It's this new way of skating. It's like edge skating. Before, it was fucking skate straight ahead and fucking hammer the wall, go right to the net.
Put the guy in the third row.
You know.
Oh, just run him through the end of
now,
the class.
All these, like the Skinners, the you know, Skinner's like a figure skater, fucking great on his edges.
Yeah.
Scores a bunch of goals every year as well.
My point to this whole thing is this Klingberg boys can fucking get every shot through because he walks the line. You saw it yesterday on the Pavelski goal. Where he's just, his feet, with one glide, he can just open up, and it's impossible for a winger to fucking protect that, to block that shot. If your coach gives you shit for trying to fucking stay in that lane the whole time, it's impossible. So having a guy like that, you're seeing how important it is to have offensive D-men who can get pucks through. It's crucial, and it's how you score goals in the playoffs.
And it's a great point, Updog. You're right, as a D-man. And I'm going to say for a forward, Pavelski on that tip, and you guys would know, you guys both went to the... Like, that was one of the best tips I've ever seen, Broadway. He wasn't even have inside ice, gets his stick up. So without Pavelski, that goal doesn't happen either, Broadway.
Exactly. I mean, it's like you said, it's like, Klingberg, that's just an elite defenseman walking the blue line. He's got 16 assists now. And then you get Pavelski. This guy, that was 10th goal last night. This guy just scores everywhere he plays.
I think those are both great points by you boys. Uppy, what you said is so true. This series is on. It's beginning to be a man series. And I'm going to do it, boys. Cons, I'm going to do it again. I know I sound like a fucking
milk
whiner.
Carton.
I'm putting the fucking refs on the milk carton again. I'm watching the game last night. I barbecued up some nice stuff. I had burgers without a bun because I'm trying to stay light, but it probably doesn't work. Start off the game, power play for Tampa, power play for Tampa, power play for Tampa. Then what do? Then they want to swing the ice the other way and go back to Dallas.
Man.
So I just think, refs, it's the Stanley Cup Finals. Can you please stop calling fucking penalties up, dog, right?
Yeah, Stanley Cup fucking finals, boys. It's on. Let's just, you know, we have offensive fucking chances all over the ice already. Let's keep it to 2-3 power plays each a game. Like you said, you've seen John Cooper's lips. Ref the fucking game, not the score.
Yeah, all right, listen. Look, the Islanders gave up. They had those 2 4-minute fucking majors in overtime against Tampa. And you go, you know, we're Kucherov. He had a bloody nose, but like he didn't get cut. His nose was bleeding. That was a bad call. But if guys are getting given penalties, you got to call them.
I agree. But the 5-on-5 play is huge. It's the whole flow of the game. And if you start doing power plays, you start killing the flow, and then guys are going to get out of rhythm, and it's going to screw the entertainment factor of the game. So I just think we got to get this 5-on-5. All the time here, and it's so much fun watching these guys just run each other.
Can we laugh at the big rig yesterday, Patty Maroon, when he went in?
That's
I don't think he skated that fast since he was probably fucking...
That's top speed for the big
17 years old and probably 180 pounds. He went in so fast, got a great chance. Great chance. Shot it off the pad. Came in. Fucking barrels over Godobin. It's a hockey play. It's fucking. Yeah. You're going to the net. It's impossible. Now, if the goalie's in the crease and you do that, and he flies into the back of his net, penalty. Or if you score, if there's an offensive chance right after that, and Tampa scores, ref's decision, maybe call. Like no goal, then an interference, but you can't just fucking throw a guy in the box for that. I think that those kind of penalties kind of separate, you know, ruin the flow of the game. It really does.
Up Dog Broadway Cons, great points on that. It's Stanley Cup final. And listen, this time next week, you know, it's going to be game 5 or 6, or, you know, is the series still going to be going on? It's 1-1. Uppy, give me your final thoughts on how this series is going to go moving forward.
Yeah, next week this thing can be over, boys. And my milk carton, I'm going to throw this out there right quick, is the fucking NHL for bringing the Stanley Cup already out and showing it before the fucking game one. That tradition that was ruined. Fucking players should not see the Stanley Cup in the rink, on the ice, before a closeout game in either overtime.
Exactly.
Or when they're up fucking 4-0 with fucking 6 minutes to go and, you know, the fucking white gloves come out.
Yeah.
And the fucking, the carton opens up, the crate opens up, and there's the fucking Lord Stanley Silverman. That's when you see it. So yes, we got 2 weeks and this thing's over, boys. The bubble has been a huge success. I love fucking watching playoff hockey. This has been incredible. We got a best of 5.
Is it going? Is it
going to fucking it's going six.
Is it going
six? Yeah, six, going seven six games. Seven. We're going to see some. I hope we keep the physical play up. We're going to see some fucking big moments, some big goals, some fucking big plays by some big players. And all I can say is, I hope to see Steven Stamkos back.
Ooh. Listen, I think the expression "Game 7" is thrown around a little often for me, but I think this one's going to go 7 games, maybe 6, but I'm going to say 7 games. And as far as who's going to win, you know, we talked about it a little bit earlier. At the end of the day, there's a few guys on each team that you wouldn't mind see hoisting the cup. I'm a big Jamie Benn fan. I'd like to see that. And then again, you know, there are guys on Tampa Bay, those fucking losers, that probably deserve it. So there's either way, there's winners. You know, there's guys that you're going to want to see be successful.
Broadway Jimmy Hayes, what do you got?
I think it's definitely going 7 because the JW Marriott staff is not letting anybody get out there early. And I just think I got Tampa in 7. And I honestly think Steven Stamkos is making an appearance in this series. I don't know when, but he is coming back.
That's a great point by you, Broadway. I agree. The boys don't want to leave the bubble yet for the JW. I forgot to bring this up earlier. Great job, Broadway. Steven Stamkos. I knew him as a kid. I love him. Uppy, if I'm in his situation, I heard it's a core injury. Do you do whatever it takes to play, or do you just let the team do it if you're Steven Stamkos? Do you play, yes or no?
Oh, yeah. I'm eating whatever I need to eat. Perk daddies, or I'm jumping in. I'm taping Advil to it. I am playing in pain. There's fucking A. I'm going, boys. I played this game way too long. If I have a chance to win the Stanley Cup with my boys and I can move my feet and John Cooper puts me in the lineup, I'm fucking playing. I'm the captain of this team. It's my team. Let's go.
Personally, I think if it weren't the Stanley Cup Finals, you wouldn't see him. My guess is if Tampa gets off to a good lead, they're going to let him dress up and skate around so he can, you know, grab the cup and lift it up and he's in uniform and he will have played a couple games. But I don't think he's an impact player in this series at all. And I also think that John Cooper's a bit of a creep.
and there's no bitterness still towards the Tampa Bay Lightning.
I don't like him. He's smug and he's a fucking creep. And I'm glad I said it.
I actually heard that guy goes to Gaza Ranch and gets pinned, but I've heard he's kind of
fucking
a different
creep.
Broadway, give us final thoughts with you, buddy, on Stammer. Does he play? Should he play?
I think Stamkos is gonna play because him at 50% is better than 80% of the league to begin with. So I think he's gonna get his ass out there.
Welcome back from break, and obviously thanks to our boy Broadway Jimmy Hayes weekly. Huge part of missing curfew. And now we got a real friend of the pod, a guy from Philadelphia we've known for a long time. Our boy, your boy, Up Dog. What do you got to say about this guy?
The king of the backdoor tap-ins. And the premier, let's be honest,
yeah,
one of our best friends, one of one to party with. This guy from Philadelphia who is you know, the premier jeweler of the NHL and all athletes all over the fucking planet. Larry Flowers.
Boys, how are you? Thanks for having me.
Larry Flowers Jeweler, right? That's what it is?
Flowers Jewelry on Instagram.
You might see billboards in and around California and probably soon all over the country. Who the fuck is Larry Flowers?
Yeah, who, that's a great billboard. Who the fuck is Larry Flowers?
In case anyone's wondering, he's right here and he's a beauty.
Do you know that our buddy down in California has the Jenga blocks, right? Jaffe has the Jenga blocks. I was over there the other night when I fell off the wagon cons. And
is
I'm
that
playing.
When he disappeared for 4 days?
No, that was when he blocked you accidentally on his contact. And he actually hadn't disappeared. He just fucked it
and
up.
And you do the Jenga, right? Yeah. You look at it, whatever's on the fucking block you got to do. And the one thing it says is, who the fuck is Larry Flowers?
I wonder who put that on there.
Boys, thanks for having me on. This is the studio is beautiful. We've been doing this basically for a long time, and now it's official, so congrats.
Thank you. So this is your first time in the studio, right?
It sure is.
Con's made it fucking National League, didn't he?
It's beautiful. Really is. Congrats.
Like my jersey selection out in the hallway?
It'd be better if you had a Flowers one up there, but you know.
Well, Flowers Blues jersey. The Flowers Blues jersey in there. It's going hot on fucking on the internet.
Double zero. He's not gonna, it's signed by the whole squad. Fuck, I tell
you. He's not going to put up your Pee Wee Junior Flyers fucking jersey in the studio.
It was midget double A.
Flowers, real quick, let's touch on your summer real quick. Where have you been? What have you been doing all summer, brother?
Yeah, I went home July 4th to see my mother for her 70th and spent my summer down the shore, Jersey Shore, and it was really great.
Perfect
good
for
to
you.
Be back, though.
Perfect for you. Jersey did you see?
Yeah, he's fucking dead. You fit in the Jersey Shore. I've never been, but
no
I think
shirt,
you.
No shirt.
Boy, it's nicer than you think, I swear.
Actually, he's got a little fucking, thumping cabin he's got there, doesn't he? Little one bedroom. I know he goes back and chases
babes.
All
I need is 350 square feet.
All you need is 350 square feet and 30 seconds and you can get it done, can't you?
Kill's a kill.
I'm like, yeah, kill is a kill, Flowers. Flowers, I don't know if I ever told you this, but my first year in the American League rookie party was in Atlantic City.
Get out.
I actually tried to fight Pierre Pronto on the bus after the fucking rookie party. But yeah, I was in Atlantic City. I was 19 years old.
She's a bit grimy in Atlantic City.
I liked it though. Yeah. And we had to leave because the bus was leaving. And I was like, fuck that. Let's get a room here. They're like, our captain, Casey Higgins, is like, oh, but you can't. You got
to
go back.
Yeah, but you have to get back on the team bus.
You got to. But I mean,
the National League now, buddy.
No, that was the American League. That was a jungle,
yeah,
baby.
Fuck that. Get a room.
Sometimes getting on that team bus is the worst thing to do. You might as well just, sometimes you like to stay and get a little. A little greasy.
That's why you've been AC before, huh?
I used to throw, we used to throw team parties when I played with the Flyers at the Borgata. and, call it what it is. One day, me and Lupo fucking, after a game, we made a decision to either go back home to Philly after we won a game or just fucking bomb across the Walt Whitman Bridge, about a 45-minute drive right into AC. Went to the Borgata.
Let me guess what you guys did.
Went to the Borgata.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say you guys went to the Borgata.
Listen, stayed up super late. Jumped in our car in our suits to go back to practice. Pulled me over.
Oh, yeah. Fuck.
About 7 a.m. I'm out fucking in the middle of this rainstorm. Cop has full trench coat on. I have his shirt and tie still on. We went to bed. It wasn't like a fucking all-night bender.
Were you in the Alpina?
No, I had an M6 at the time.
Sick.
Still being a guy,
National League guy. Yeah, that's okay.
So Loops is in the passenger seat, and he pretty much thinks this is a full joke. Like, the cop is like, excuse me, sir, can you step outside the vehicle? I'm like, all right, fuck. So I get out there, and he has me in the middle of this pouring rain do the old walk fucking straight line.
The heel toe express.
And let me tell you, I wasn't still pinned nothing.
Come on.
He might have smelt a little booze, maybe seen some lipstick on my collar. But I got out, and I fucking walked this straight line. But then he has me do, like, the nose touch. And I've never been part of, like, a fucking DUI test in my life. And I'm fucking touching my nose. Now Lupel's like, okay, joke's over. Like, we got to be to practice.
Yeah.
And so he texts a couple guys, like, hey, fuck, just so you know, we might be a little late. Next thing you know, I'm looking at Loops. I'm like, you got to call team security. Like, we might literally miss practice.
Loops is like, fuck, I'm on the first power play unit here. I'm going to get back.
So, lo and behold, I was sober and I did pass this fucking test with flying colors.
Fuck.
Meanwhile, I need to go home first, get a full new suit and tie because my fucking thing was drenched. But, AC.
So you passed the field sobriety, but they didn't make you blow.
They did not make me blow.
Thank God.
You never blow, right?
Because you never know what you're going to blow in the morning.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Totally. If they made you blow, you probably would have been in jail.
You never blow.
How's that AC jail? Probably. Does it have any air conditioning in there? Does the AC jail have any AC?
That's a fucking scary story, though.
That is. That
God, I'll be that kid.
So,
cautionary tale right there, bro.
Yeah, that's why, you know. Good for you, though. Way to get out of it. I never drink and drive, ever. But fucking A.
We never drink and drive unless it's out of the golf course before the sun goes down, because then it doesn't feel like you're drinking and driving.
And that's why Getsy gives us a Sprinter van when we come up here and we have a couple Coors Lights.
Getsy, we're going to need that Sprinter van a little
more. Getsy stuff. Flowers. Yeah, you guys looking for that fucking Sprinter van?
We need that Sprinter van, Getsy. We love you. We need that Sprinter. Flowers, did you know the Up Dog and Loops when they played for the Flyers?
I knew Loops. I met Loops when he was in Philly. His last year in Philly, actually. I met him in LA, actually, at a game when he was injured. We Shocker. Went upstairs. Cody introduced us.
Just joking, Loops.
Yeah. Cody introduced us, our boy Cody, and been friends ever since. Met you, beauties. And
I remember that game. Loops came in and was like, fuck, I think my groin's pretty sore tonight. Yeah. I'm looking at him. I'm like, what? He's like, yeah, the groin's pretty sore. Like, I probably could push through it, but fuck, I got to get up to Hollywood after this sick party. I'm like, well, my back's sore too. Fuck.
So now that your boy is with Lupo and Upshaw, and looking back as a diehard Flyers fan, so I know you are, when you watch these guys play hockey, were you like, fuck, these guys play hard. Upshaw goes to the net. Lupo's got a fucking sick release. They're both good-looking guys. These are guys I want to fucking mix it with and miss curfew with them. Is that something you were thinking about?
Obes, totally. I mean, obviously, I'm a diehard Flyers fan, but I enjoyed watching Loops and Uppy play. Loops is an unbelievable player. Man, can he snap it around. And Uppy was... He made me laugh then, and he makes me laugh now. He plays so hard. He falls to the wall.
Gotta go full up, dog.
I loved watching them play, and I knew the rumors in Philly were that these guys are beauties.
And you were proud of that Flyers team, right? And then listen, I'm saying, I tell Uppy and Loops this all the time, especially when we start having a few and talk old hockey. That Flyers team, when they were there, I'm telling you, if you have anyone but fucking Boucher and Ned, or who fucking, I don't know who you had, but that team, you guys, you were tough. You had character. They fucked.
We had an all fuck team.
They fucked.
I wanted to say that. We had an all fuck team.
They would have won if they didn't break that team up.
I had a hard time when they broke that team up personally as a Flyers fan. I probably haven't completely gotten over that. They had an unbelievable team. They were right there. I'm convinced another year or two they would have won a mug.
There was major cap issues. Paul Holmgren built a fucking gem of a team when he took over from Bobby Clark at the time, which... A
couple
of
legends there.
The first year, he moves Forsberg, brings me in.
Great trade. Great fucking trade.
No, but it was all this deal. It was a transaction in the summer that brought Tiemannin, Hartnell, Danny Briere, Joffrey Leupold, Jason Smith, all in with just shipping Forsberg, Joni Pitkinen and Jeff Sanderson out. He created, you know, we went from a team last place in the league to the conference finals this year. So, you know, there was a little mishap, but we ran into cap issues and fuck, we were buzzing.
But does that have something to say with Ed Snyder? I mean, that guy, he was an unbelievable owner, one of the best owners in the NHL. This guy loved the Flyers like his own children. He was not afraid to spend money. You don't see that in the Flyers anymore. Obviously, they're corporate owned now, and it's just a different feel. And as a Flyers fan, it hurts me a little bit to not see them go balls of the wall for those fans. They are diehard fans. They don't have guys.
I'll tell you what they are. They're fucking mutants.
They are mutants. But guess what? If you look at the Flyers now, they're not the type of team now that any other team in the NHL would be like, fuck, we're playing the Flyers. This is gonna get ugly. This is gonna be tough. Like, they owe it to the fans of Philadelphia to be tough, to have something more than just a finesse type of team. And that's who they are now.
There used to be a piece of writing on the wall when you'd walk into our practice facility in Voorhees, which was a sick facility at the time. It used to say...
Why didn't it say, did you wear a condom last night?
Condoms are for sailors, is what it said.
Don't fucking wear condoms.
No, it basically said, when you walk in here, the jersey speaks for itself. The team will do everything else. So if you fucking play here and play with this jersey, this team will look after you, your family. They will fucking make sure everything is taken care of. And I think what Flowers is trying to say is, now that this thing is not run by the late Ed Snyder, who literally built it, he was a pioneer for the NHL, but brought the Stanley Cups there in the 70s. This, you know, this corporate run organization right now, is it a place that players want to go to? Do they treat the players the same way?
Cons, what are your thoughts as an Islander on the Flyers, on the fucking, you want to talk Broad Street Bullies back in the day? What do you want to talk about?
Listen. I mean, come on. The Islanders have done nothing but beat the Flyers historically in the Cup Finals and right up until this year, where no matter who owned them, the Islanders have been smacking them around. Clark Gillies dropped your boy Schultz in 1978, and that was it. There was no looking back. But that's not my question. Flyers, I thought you were a Blues fan.
They're my Western Conference team, boys.
We're going to get into the Blues. You want to get right into the Blues right now?
I want to get into Flowers in the Blues. I mean, he's talking
okay, listen.
All the,
Do you want me to tee it up? I'm going to tee it up. Does everyone know the story? Our list?
People want to know. Oh,
I'm
going to
say it like this.
It.
This is, you've been waiting for this moment for a long time. I'm going to give it to you.
We want
to
hear it.
Make it count.
We want to hear it.
Okay, listen. So it all started with Uppy. It's Uppy's fault. Listen, there's no better guy than Flowers. Come all star break. Like, Flowers, listen, jump on a bird. I got your ticket paid for. Just fucking show up and have a time. Because as we all know, Flowers is a great team guy. Can talk to the girls, and even sometimes the girls like him back. So he's not a bad guy to have around there. But then how does his story go after that, Uppy? He gets in with these St. Louis Blues guys, and what happens after that?
So it speaks for itself. The story will speak for itself because we all love Flowers for more than one reason. But we also laugh at Flowers for more than one reason. Now, I brought him to St. Louis my first year there. I introduced him to the guys. At the time, he's just Flowers. He's going out. He's not doing... He isn't full Flowers, you know. He's meeting a bunch of new NHL guys, and
he's putting up a good front.
He is the premier jeweler to the NHL, and he's worked hard at it, and he's fucking great at it. But what he also is good at is setting up a good fucking party. And I had him to come to Cabo for our first fucking inaugural.
I'll tell you what he's not good at is grabbing the fucking check. But anyways, keep going.
So he comes into Cabo with us. We got a fucking, you know, we got a nice setup. We got Bertuzzo, Fabbri, Schwartzy, Joel Edmondson, my crew of single boys at the time, and we go in there to rip a 3-4 day weekend. And of course I'm like, all right, I'm gonna bring my boy Flowers. He's good. He'll come in. He's quick flight from, you know, Southwest Bird,
middle
LA.
Seat Southwest.
He'll be there, but he's a good time.
C32F. They come up on the tarmac.
So he came in best kind. And the boys love him. Fuck, he's setting up the broads at the fucking, you know, at the table. He's organizing it. He's doing all the legwork, which you need. And young players
like an
actually
equipment manager,
that.
But at a club.
Yeah, exactly. That's not a bad way to look at it.
Yeah, he kind of puts you in a good situation.
He's
to
like
succeed.
Frosty, but at the club.
I mean, and although he's 41, he looks like he could be, you know, 30.
He's youthful. So he's got youthful good looks.
He still looks pretty good, yeah.
That's kind of what I was doing in L.A. when I first, you know, obviously met all the hockey guys. Cody introduced me to a bunch of the boys, and teams would come to L.A. He was done doing it. He used to take teams out, our boy Cody. And I would take teams out, set up the rookie dinners, and then take them to nightclubs and make sure everything was run properly. And
are you
saying
you're better doing that than Cons? Because Cons has set up a couple of parties.
That's not even the same fucking breath. I'm going to step in there. Connelly,
I would say I'm better than most people, but not Cons.
Not Cons.
Not the captain. So Flowers, the thing about you, though, is you did have a lasting effect on these guys. And ultimately, that brought you into what was probably the biggest fucking fan experience in NHL history.
Let's be honest.
You bring these guys to Philly in this little mutant bar. How does it start?
So the Blues are in last place in the National Hockey League.
Of last year's epic season.
After the All-Star, after the January 1.
And they go to
place,
Philly,
right?
And you decide to take them to some bar, right?
Yeah, right. So the Eagles are playing a playoff game, and I talked to all my boys on the Blues, and I said, hey, boys, why don't you come watch the game with me? Maybe, you know, relax a little, enjoy the night. We'll set up a little thing at a private bar in South Philly. And, you know, we had a bunch of the guys come, Steiner, Bortuzzo, Fabs, Eddie, Schwartzy, all decide to come. And we set up a beauty crew. And we set up a great, great night, big crowd. It was very, very private. And what goes on in this bar?
A little
dancing, DJ we had set up. We had a ton of food, some good Italian food made by moms. A
couple extracurricular activities.
You know. And we were having a great time, and our DJ kept playing the Gloria song, and Fabs Fab's a young guy.
Who is Fabs?
Robbie Fabbri.
Okay,
good kid, really good kid.
I don't know his nickname.
This was a '70s.
That's a good call, Con. It's a good call.
This was a massive hit in the '70s, and he's never heard of it. Pretty popular song in South Philly. It's a popular
bar song in general, right?
Totally.
But these guys don't know, so they discover it at this club you take them to?
Exactly, the private bar. And Fabs starts yelling, play.
Bar.
He loves the song, and he starts yelling,
Gentlemen's Club.
He's yelling, all dudes?
It was a shithole.
It was a great shithole.
Perfect for you guys.
And Fabs is yelling, he loves the song, play Gloria. So they keep playing this fucking song. Finally, Steiner looks at me. He's like, Flowers. He's like, fuck, our team's in one. You know, we're expecting a huge season this year, and I don't know what to do. You know, he's one of the leaders in that
captain
team.
Captain of the team.
He's such a beauty.
He's a really nice guy.
And he looks at me, and he's like, you know, man, fuck, I'll tell you what. If we win tomorrow, I'm going to play this song in the locker room. Maybe it's a little victory song. Who the fuck knows? I said, that sounds like a good idea. Sure as shit. The next night, they play the Flyers. And some kid named Jordan Binnington, ever heard of him? For his first NHL start, gets a shutout.
That was his first start?
Ever.
Holy fuck, the stars were aligned for your Flyers.
I was kind of crying because they beat the Flyers, shut them out, but fuck.
Yeah, were you upset that they, you were probably pissed that the Flyers lost. Be honest.
Honestly, I wasn't.
You're fucking lying right to my face.
He's already on the bandwagon.
You're fucking lying to my face.
I was happy for the guys. It's his first NHL start. Come on.
Do you think I would ever do that to the Islanders? Do you think I would sit there and go like, I was kind of happy that the Red Wings beat the Islanders last night because I really like this Federal. Fuck that!
Schenner threw a bunch of... He threw a pair of gloves at my nephew during warm-ups. I mean, I got to root for the Blues a little bit.
The nicknames. Come on.
Braden Schenn. Three-year-old nephew.
He's fucking good.
You know, I have to say this quick story. Sean Avery does a podcast here at Action Park Media, and fucking lo and behold, I get my Twitter gets lit up. People want to kill Avery. They call me a traitor. But the truth of the matter is, my nephew is a diehard Ranger fan. I hate him. We don't speak anymore. He's a diehard Ranger fan. He was a kid, and after opening season game, like first season of the game, Islanders just destroy the Rangers in the Coliseum. And out comes Aves, and he's fucking in one. He looks good. His suit is amazing.
Always looking good.
And his hair looks great, but you could just tell he's on tilt. And he wanted to fucking walk right by me. But not only did he stop, but he signed and gave my nephew a signed, real deal Sean Avery jersey. And family is important, so Avery always won me over from that point in. Other than when he plays the Islanders, we got to smash him. But that's it.
I mean, watching Aves do his little clips he does now in NHL playoff is fucking great. I watched that in the intermission instead of fucking listening to NHL NBC. I go, let's see what Aves is saying, because I can't listen to fucking Sharpie and fucking Jones.
And Sharpie's handsome, though.
Messed his hair up, though, a bit. Yeah. Mess it up a bit, fuck.
Yes. So Binnington gets a 3-0 shutout.
Crazy. That was the first start.
First start ever.
That's when he used to start, right?
That was his first start in the NHL.
But that was when he used to play.
Zinger.
And sure shit, they play the song in the locker room. They go and have another game. They win another game. They play the song again. They get on a little hot streak. Then they have the break. We go to Cabo, you and I and the boys. We come back from that trip, and they go on a 10-game win streak. And they're playing this fucking song in the locker room after every win. And eventually, there's a story breaking. I go on another podcast. I tell the story, and now all of a sudden, it becomes a national story. And they not only climb out of the cellar, but they make it to the playoffs. They make it to the finals. You have every single news outlet in the country covering hockey at this bar in South Philly with all these mutants, all these guys I know that are rooting for the Blues. There's Blues flags outside. You got sports radio in Philadelphia just saying they hate this bar. They're all traitors.
Wow.
Is there an Updog jersey in there now?
There's an Updog jersey in there that Updog signed a sick tarp, and they have it on the wall now. It'll be there forever. People in Philly were pissed. People in Philly were pissed because they're like, you guys are South Philly diehard Flyers guys.
I'm pissed for them.
Yeah, but
I agree with them.
I'm still a little pissed myself, too.
But the story goes, they not only make it to the finals, but they win the fucking cup.
We know how.
Okay, listen, we know how the story goes.
I live in a fucking cave.
So we're
going to
get
cave?
Into this.
I know how the story
Okay,
is.
Listen, this is where the story turns for me, Flowers. Yeah, okay, yeah. I love you.
Let's tell the stories now,
boys. First of all, let me just say this. Before we go into this, Larry, I'd like to say thank you for help with the Christmas present for my girlfriend. Larry Flowers helped me with an absolutely beautiful watch for my girl. I don't know fucking shit.
Wow.
Is this
an ad read already?
No. Flowers came in and he helped me out. So, look.
Cons, I appreciate it. It's my pleasure, buddy. You've done so much for us. We love you.
That being said,
you may sing a different tune, Kevin, when you hear what Larry Flowers said on the car ride up. Larry Flowers said, now listen, so I was hard on my boy Flowers. As an ex-player who had never won a Stanley Cup, you do not hoist that motherfucker over your head unless you competed out there. Unless you block shots, you got hit in the face, you fucking battle with the ups and downs. So he does it. And Cons, he says it
on the ice. Sorry, I'll get
back. He goes on the ice and hoists the mug over his fucking head.
That's fucked.
And Cons,
up,
he man. Says, he goes on the way up, he goes, you know what? I got something to fucking say to Cons. If the Islanders won it, Cons would go out there and put his fucking, he would do the exact same thing, blah, blah, blah. And we said, me and up here, like, Collins has been an Islanders fan his whole fucking life.
Mind.
He's the ambassador of the squad. He would not do it. So Collins Flowers is comparing his loyalty to the Blues as the same as you to the Islanders.
First of all, you have six different hockey teams.
I have one.
Okay.
Who is it this year?
I have the Islanders and only the Islanders. And second of all, look, I believe, Larry, you got caught up in the moment. And I think you rolled with it. And I think you probably should have. And good for you. And thank you for the Christmas present. That said, I would fucking set myself on fire before I stepped foot on the ice in an Islander jersey and hoisted the fucking Stanley Cup above my head.
I don't know if I believe
and
you,
and I
cons.
Would never fucking stand on the parade float. I'm wouldn't be in a suit
I
with the owners.
I don't know if I believe him, boys.
I do, Flowers. I love you.
Listen,
you knew you were going to get this when you came in here. You knew
I would be in the suite with the owners in a suit talking about four different goals that were opening up in new arenas.
Here's the thing.
Cons is a businessman.
Here's the thing. I'm invited on the ice after they win the mug.
Fuck you.
Braden Schenn and Schwartzy and Bortuzzo are raising the mug.
I don't give a
Schenn
fuck.
Schenn looks right at me. He turns to me. He goes, "Hey, Flowers, get ready. It's coming your way." I go, No. He goes, "Be ready.
Be ready.
Don't
you're
drop
wearing
it.
A jersey so and
goes,
you're skating around.
He
you
goes,
put,
he put his skates on.
I mean, you had skates and he fucking goes to socks on.
He goes to hand me the mug. What am I to do? I obviously
you don't put it
it's
over
a
your
once in a
head.
Life it's a once in a lifetime. I raise the mug. It
over your head.
Over
do
my
you
head.
Feel bad if you could go back? Would you take it? Would you not go? Now let's say you had the double zeros. Let's say you snuck onto the parade float and even on the stage, which was weird.
Yeah, this is where the story.
If you could take one back,
a lot more
do you
story
not
to
hoist
tell.
The cup.
That's a good question. And to be completely honest with you, boys, I would still raise that.
And listen,
we know, Flowers. Yeah, you didn't even need to say that.
So,
well, thank God you said that because that's the only way out. Because now we're left.
Well, so this happens. We fly back. I fly back to St. Louis. I get invited to be on a float in the parade. Okay, in the Blues parade.
Fuck.
I'm on the float with Bortuzzo. I gotta say that was
this
one
is
of
all Uppy's fault, by the way.
This is that was.
No, it's not Uppy's fault.
I'm still blaming Uppy. I'm blaming Uppy.
It is Uppy's fault.
Who's
for
the captain
sure
of that team?
Well,
Petro
it's supposed to be
Petro,
but
well,
it's
Petro should have fucking dropped the hammer on that one.
But they knew.
Anders
that's
Lee
my point. My point is they all knew. They knew that I was part of the story. They wanted to. I mean, I guess they just wanted to. Say a little thank you to me and invite me
for
into the
you
parade.
Thank
I'm
you
just
for
saying.
What?
Listen.
I'm just
thank
saying.
You for what?
Hey, listen, I will give you credit. The boys do love you. There's no arguing that. But when you're on the fucking float and on
stay
the stage.
On the fucking float.
So listen, now, Cons, I'm going through this with Uppy, and I will give Uppy credit for this because as an ex player, I went through it with Anaheim. One of the hardest things to do is to watch guys that you love and you've battled, been through, and you have moved on and watched them win the Stanley Cup. And Uppy, till this day, I will give you the most credit in the world because you truly wanted these fucking guys to win. And as an ex-player, I respect that, brother.
I respect that, too. And oh. I also had that thought.
And from a fucking guy that's cheering for Ryan O'Reilly, I'm like, I want Factor in the cup, but I do not want to see Larry Flowers with the fucking Stanley Cup because I knew Conn's what he's going to do. I'm like, this guy, he can't help himself. He's part of the thing. He's going to hoist the motherfucker. And sure enough, I get a picture of this guy, Updog, hoisting the fucking
yeah,
mug.
By the way, also, too, Flowers, did you see me just fucking lighting you up all over Instagram?
Oh, we're all lighting you up. Everyone was lighting me up, and I got to say, it was the first time in my life where it just didn't sting.
Yo, do you want to know what the craziest thing was? I was getting incoming material from fans that I did not know. People knew that I was lighting you up, and they were sending me photos.
I mean,
people
boys,
that I didn't know were giving me ammunition to blast you on.
Listen, we finally get the end of the parade is right.
No.
The end of the parade is literally.
The Blues get to the end
blues,
of the parade.
The Blues, Flowers.
The fucking freeloader on fucking cart 22.
The parade ends under the arch in St. Louis. And the whole team is walking up to the steps to the back of the stage to walk onto the stage. We're all walking on together. I stop. I look at Steiner. I go, this is the end of the road for me. This was an unbelievable moment. Well, obviously, we're all nice and buzzed, just a ton of beers during the parade. And I go, I'm done. I'm not getting on the stage. There's a million people in front of the stage. And I shit you not, boys. Steiner grabs me by the shirt. He goes, oh, no, Flowers. You're fucking with us. And I go, no. He goes, let's go. And he grabs me, brings me onto the stage. All the guys on the team are raising the mug in front of the whole crowd. And finally, one of the guys is
finally you get to raise it.
One of the guys is raising the mug, And
did you
Jake
raise
Allen,
it on the fucking
The
snake,
fucking guy
man.
Raised it twice over
Jake
his head.
Allen, Jake the Snake Allen looks at me and he goes, Flowers, I got this thing next and it's coming to you. I go, please don't. Enough. No, no. He goes, it's coming to you. Be ready. Sure as shit, he raises the cup in front of a million people, turns around and hands me this fucking thing and grabs my phone and takes the sickest picture I'll ever own to the day I die. And
my favorite is like,
what can
was,
I say?
There was one picture with you and I, God knows who on that team shirtless. And you're like draped over the cup, like game seven, triple overtime grinder. And you just fucking could barely stand up all your weight.
So, like all my shoulder hurts. My
pressed over
the yeah, black eye.
So
who was that? The shirtless man that you were with.
I don't know, but I'll
pull it out of my Twitter. I got it.
It's in Vegas. I think it was with Bertuzzo.
Since all you guys are in the chirping mood, I might as well just keep going into the story.
Yeah. Tell us about the fucking
so
private bird.
We go from the stage back into the arena. Everyone goes into the locker room. The locker
guys
room.
All head back into
I have
the
my
locker
own,
room.
I have my
your
own
stall.
I have my own stall right next to that blaze. And we all take showers, get ready to go on the private bird.
Did you shower with the boys?
Shower with the boys.
You were showering.
It's like the 80s Oilers, fuck's sake.
You're telling me that you took a shower with the team before the team plant before you got on the plane to Vegas? That's
swinging
a new
dicks
low.
Everywhere,
that's a new
fella.
Low.
I sure did. I'm in the locker room. We take
that's
showers.
Nuts. Did you
fluff it up a bit before you went in there with the boys? Or
I always do.
Did you have the half chub?
A fucking lesson from me or what? You always gotta have a half.
Always. So we get on the bus first, right? To go to the airport to get on the private bird, and we're on the bus, and that Sammy Blaze kid is standing next to Steiner, who's sitting next to me, and he says, I don't have my wallet. You know, I lost my wallet. Someone stole my wallet. And everyone's like, what the fuck are you talking about? You can't get on the plane without your ID. Where's your wallet? So everything's going sideways. We can't leave. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, what if I stole his wallet and they think I stole it and my whole entire experience gets ruined? But obviously that's not the case. I would never do that. So they're looking for this kid's wallet. No one can find it. We can't leave the arena. And sure shit, I'm like, you know what? Just for shits and giggles, let me check my pocket. So I reach in my pocket, I pull out my wallet, I'm like, phew, it's mine. It's a black and it's a checkered black and gray Louis Vuitton wallet. I'm like, phew, it's mine.
Fake one
then
for
I,
sure.
Then I open the wallet and I'm like, oh, holy shit, this is Sammy Blaze's wallet. And Steiner's sitting next to me and everyone's starting to look at me like, did you yank his wallet, Flowers? I mean, we know you're from Philly, but would you do that? And I'm like, holy shit. People are looking at me like, I'm free. So finally, I'm like, hold on, let me check the other. I check my other pocket. I pull out. We have the same exact fucking wallet. His stall was next to mine in the locker room. It was on
oh,
top
God.
Of his shirt.
Yeah, well, that's what happened.
He's missing a couple, missing a couple
so the,
20s.
So the bus erupts in laughter. We go over to the airport. We get on the bird. All of a sudden, the captain comes to the back of the bird. Again, Steiner's sitting next to me. The captain says, guys, you know, I have the list here of all the names and the IDs. There's one too many
and this
names.
This fucking not joker's not on it.
There's, I wasn't. There's not enough seats for the on the bird. Like, what's going on? Everyone's like, fuck, you know, obviously it's because of me. So Steiner says, I got this. Walks to the front of the bird, leans over to the three guys handling the cup. And, you know, we're like, what's he doing? And kind of looks back, gives us a little thumbs up and comes back. And sure as shit, they sent one of the handlers, I guess the low man on the totem pole. They sent him on a commercial flight to Vegas.
They bounced one of the equipment managers
They bounced one of the three guys who take care of the cup.
Not the trainers, Cons, the cup guy.
So the guys that travel around with that
the guys that
cup,
took the cup to goal, my boys. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
what's
yeah
up?
Your boys. Yeah. Now they only need one of those fucking
what's
guys.
Up? What's up?
So yeah, so we fly to Vegas.
Can I tell the one thing here? So I'm on Twitter following the Blues, right? My boy O'Reilly, like fucking Conn Smythe.
By the way, Obi, I'm sure he knows this. You love O'Reilly.
I love O'Reilly.
He's your like league idol. Yeah?
I played with him when he was 21 years old. Yeah, like I
learned a lot from
him. I've had the privilege of knowing hundreds of guys in the NHL. He is probably the coolest man I've ever met in the NHL.
Yeah,
he's one of them.
Well.
I mean, one of them.
Within reason.
Yeah, you know, naked in the shower. Of course he thinks he's sick.
I met the kid when he was 21, and I'm not trying to say I'm fucking... I looked at him, and I saw the way he carried himself and how obviously how he played the game. I'm like, this kid's going to win. And whatever happened to him, Buffalo, they ship him out of town. Anyways, I'm watching the fucking team come in, the MGM. Where were you staying?
MGM.
So now you're coming in the boys' National League style, right, Cons? With the rolly bag and National League. It's just like O'Reilly, Petrangelo, Steen, Delzato, Flowers, Binnington. And I'm like, I text up, so I'm like, that's too much, bro. This is too fucking
Louis
much.
Louis Vuitton, Gucci. Yeah, Swiss.
I'm like, I don't even know Flowers owned a roller bag or knew what one of those fucking things were. All he has is a backpack usually anywhere he goes.
I'll never forget it. It was last year. It was during our Balboa, our member at our country club, which I happened to win.
I knew you. I was about to tee up, but I figured you'd take it yourself.
I tell the boys, I'm like, listen, the Blues won the cup last night. I'm meeting them in Vegas. They invited me to Vegas. We were supposed to go no matter what. I always love fucking partying with my boys. And this is kind of a tough one, though, because they do have the cup. But I'm like, fuck it, I'm going to go in. I'm actually pretty much fucking drunk as a skunk.
And everyone wanted
anyway.
You there, by the way.
Well, yeah, and you should have been there.
Everyone was asking me, where's Upshaw? Get him out here. Everyone.
Because he knows all the broads. He knows all the broads. Yeah, get him out here.
They don't want you there because they like you. They just
this Stanley Cup party sucks with all dudes. Get up here.
Boys,
totally.
So I take a 10 o'clock fucking bird in. I land around 11. These guys are coming out of dinner. I go straight there. I don't even have a bag. I go straight to the fucking restaurant. You guys got out of fucking STK or whatever. I'm walking in.
Just a toothbrush.
In fucking, like you said, in pops the doors and fucking Petro's bringing out fucking all the boys. And so Steiner grabs me. I give him a big hug. Congrats. I shake fucking Schwartzy's hand and give him a fucking big kiss. I look, Flowers is looking at me. He's like, come on my bus. I'm like, what? Come on. What fucking bus do you have? So he's like, no, come on the back bus.
You should be on the city buses where you should be.
Boys, we walk into this. They had two big fucking stretch limos. I walk in, and you know these stretch limos with fucking the poles.
The van
on them.
Ones. Yeah,
and,
the big ones.
And I got the lights in there, and it's for when fucking bunch of broads are in there, and it's party time. Well, I get on there, and the fucking silver jug is sitting right beside
it's
fucking
crazy when
Steiner,
you see it, huh?
Fact Daddy, Bertuzzo. And Flowers. And Flowers is like, Updog, come over here, man.
So Updog,
like,
come on. Just give it a next fucking to me in the mug. Rub it.
I literally, because I've never seen the mug close up, especially around my friends who have won it.
Mm-hmm.
It was fucking breathtaking. And I had literally a tear in my eye to see the guys fucking, who just were like freshly shaved.
Good for you,
Up. And then I'm just like, as if Flowers is trying to come over here and try to probably pull something out of his pocket to give me before we walk in the club. He's like, fucking come over here and sit down, fucking up, dog. Sit beside this mug.
Oppie, I've told you a million times before, and it did sting a little bit because you were a massive part of that team. The culture.
Yeah, Factor even told me that, Ups.
That's a fact. You were a big part of the culture of that
it
team.
It was tough for you, that, Larry? Like, you
it
know,
was. No.
It
really was. Oppie's like my brother. And he was a big part of that team and changing the culture and getting the young guys to know like how to act like a pro.
Yeah, get in the shooting lane.
Yeah.
How many times has Uppy got you laid, you think, in your life? On a scale, like, look at me wrong. You're good with the ladies. You're good with the ladies. You are. I'm saying, like, listen. I mean, no one's got more pussy than they probably didn't deserve than you, but what do you think, Obvious?
I don't know if I should literally say this
I'm
number
just
on,
joking.
On a
I'm
podcast.
Just joking.
Let's just say it's a good number.
Flowers, do you think that it would go over well with the Islander fan base if, like, I were on the fucking float, the parade float of the fucking... You know, of the Ducks. He caught me in a fucking 00 Ducks jersey holding the fucking mug in Newport.
00?
Are you fucking crazy? I mean, it would be weird. It would be weird.
I don't know about that.
You should have got number 88.
Yeah,
I don't
know
about
that.
I would never do it.
I think, you know what, Cons? I'm calling bullshit on you. I'm calling bullshit, and I'll tell you why. I think if one of the guys on that team, on the ice, hand you the mug and says, you raise this motherfucker right now. They win the mug.
I would say you might say that now because of this podcast, but I don't know about that. I don't care about the podcast. I speak my mind whatever the fuck I want. I would never just raise the cup. I choose not to. You chose to. That's great. That's on you. I wouldn't do it. Oops.
I told you, and this was mine. When I first saw you, you came in A restaurant. I'll never forget it. I was mad at you, Flowers. I love you like a brother.
I was scared. To be honest with you, I was scared coming into A. I was scared. I usually don't get scared because I know you wouldn't pump me, even though I know you want
no,
to.
No.
But I was scared that night.
You're a great friend. You've always been a great friend. The reason these guys love you is because you're a good dude. And you said, what am I supposed to do? I said, you do whatever the fuck you want to do. You don't raise it over your head. You don't put it on social media. But behind closed doors, you do whatever the fuck you want with that thing if the boys invited you in. And that was my point. That's all my point was.
Fair
I gave
enough.
You a big hug. Don't just go around flaunting it around, but maybe it's helping your business. Well, but anyways.
Yeah, well, that was the other thing. Well, here's my question. I love you, Flowers. Sitting there thinking to myself, and again, I was thinking, yo, if Flowers pulls this off into where he makes the rings for the Blues, all will be forgiven. All will be forgiven. I will, and not only that, I will call you a genius.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you turned around and you got the contract to make the rings, I go, this fucking guy's the smartest motherfucker ever. And what? You got no ring. Fair enough. You got me a watch for Christmas.
Cons, you're gonna be. This is an eye opener. He's gonna hit you with something.
In all fairness, a company called Jostens does all the rings in the NHL.
Until they don't.
But speaking of the ring.
Oh, but Cons listened to the story. He did not get a ring.
Text that right to Cons right now so you can see it in the back.
I did not get a ring, but in my opinion, I think what they did for me was a little bit better than giving me a ring.
Wow, what? I mean, they already fucking, Jesus Christ, they took a shower with a bunch of naked dudes after they won the cup. I mean, that alone right there. Well,
what they did instead was they put me
self-proclaimed
on the ring. Check your phone, Cons, will you?
Cons, you get that text?
If his name is on the ring,
it's not on the ring, but Cons, take a peek. It's fucking
walk out of here.
It's disgusting. It's disgusting.
Ew, what is that, bro?
That's the side of the ring, Cons, and I don't know. Maybe it's coincidence. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe they just like to put fans on the side of a ring and for Stanley Cup championship rings. Maybe, I don't know.
He's saying it's him. Does it look like him? Does it look like Flowers, Cons?
Of a fan wearing a jersey.
A super fan.
Cons, if that's not me, then
who has a jewelry company?
Who bought his own jersey?
If that's not me, Cons, then who the fuck is it? Who the fuck is it?
Yo, good work today, boys. Good podcast. I'll see you later.
The owner of Action Park Media has left the building because of Larry Flowers. He owns the building. He pays for the bills. He's leaving the building.
1-0 Flowers.
I don't know. Cons is wrapping up everything. I'll text you tomorrow.
So not only is Flowers just getting every backdoor kill on the planet Earth because he was holding the mug and whatever, but they throw him on the ring.
I mean, look at the picture, boys. I mean, if it's not me, then who the fuck is it?
I mean, that picture in the bottom is too much.
Why would they put that? If the guy on the ring didn't have
such a big nose, I would say it's not you. But
I mean, they probably did that just so. So I can't claim that it's officially me. There's a couple little changes, but I mean, why the fuck would they put that on the side of a ring?
You should ask one of the boys, like, who designed it, if it has anything to do with it.
I don't think the boys had anything to do with designing that part of the ring. And in fact, whoever did, really, if it's you, should be fired on the spot.
I'm way better looking that, I agree.
But, so, and we're going to put this out on our social media so fans can see it, but pretty impressive, Flowers.
Listen, Flowers.
I mean, the ultimate fan, buddy of the team experience you could possibly put it together.
Yeah, and listen, Flowers, we love that you came on here. We want you to come on more and more, honestly, buddy. But what you did for St. Louis, you obviously meant something to their team, and I've given you a hard time. But whatever you did to them, you did deserve it. Did you go a little too far as an ex-player? I will always say yes, but I love you. I know the Updog loves you. I know the Updog is always taking care of you, but you're always welcome here. And just for our listeners, just what's your Instagram and all that stuff if they want, because I know you get sick watches and jewelry, and just give it a quick shout out just so everyone knows.
Yeah, Larry Flowers Jewelry on Instagram. I take care of all the boys in the NHL. I do only the highest quality production and the best diamonds and watches for your budget. I hit singles and I ask for referrals in return, boys. I take good care of the boys, not only guys in the league, but everyone. Thanks for the plug.
I take good care of everyone.
That's who I am as a person, as a businessman. I try to get everyone the best deals in the industry, and that's just the way I am.
And you design shit. You design my girl an unbelievable wraparound, you know, ring, friendship ring.
Engagement rings, yeah, watches,
the stuff,
everything.
The stuff you're putting up, man, listen, I don't know. I mean, have you ever tried to talk these guys out of getting a fucking engagement ring or not? Actually, I got a great girlfriend. I'm not chirping marriage and all that stuff, but I'm one step at a time for me. Like, I got a girlfriend now, but... Hey. This marriage thing is like, what the fuck?
And if you're part of the team is being honest with a guy. You gotta tell him, like, hey, bud, you know what? I can sell you a real fucking good ring.
I will say this, and Andrew O'Brien, who's a great kid, I call him. I play with him in San Diego, and he has a beautiful girlfriend. She's from Rancho Cucamonga, and somehow this meat got him. But Angel Bryan's a great kid. And typically, I would tell young guys not to get married, but he hits me up for Flowers' number, and I'm like, Flowers, actually hook this kid up because he ain't getting any better than this one here. So
you're like, I'll buy the ring. Yeah, just make sure he gets
this,
that
this girl's a dime. Make sure you get this ring for him. But
yeah, no, I mean, guys come to me. I don't like to push guys away. Obviously, it can be a little bit of a fine line if it's a good friend. But in all honesty, I have a lot of pride, and it's an honor to do guys' engagement rings. It's a big moment in people's lives, and I do my very best to give people the very, very best deals and the highest quality, and I'm honored to do it for the boys.
I think you have such a big heart, and you're a jeweler, so you kind of feel bad because most jewelers fucking rip people off. You do take care of your boys. You stick up for fucking everyone in your life. You have great parents. You like to fucking get those backdoor kills more than anyone.
You will not take no for an answer.
But hell, you're a fucking fun guy to party with. You're a fun guy to shoot the shit with. And when anything's going on, if I need any help, any questions, I fucking call you. You're one of my first boys I call. And that's the same. I know every one of these fucking guys in the St. Louis Blues FaceTimes you every other fucking day. And that says a lot about you.
Oppie, I appreciate it, O'Brien. I appreciate it. You guys, two of my best friends. I would do anything in the world for you. But, you know, I'm a Northeast Philly guy. Loyalty, you cannot pay for that. It's the way I was raised. And you guys are exactly the same way. That's why you're my brothers. I love
you. And you know what, boys? I'm Flowers. I'm proud of you because you had a raw deal. I'm going to get into everything a couple years ago. You pulled your socks up. You turned into a pro. But I got to be honest, boys. I miss the Sprinter van. I miss getting fucking banged up on the weekend. And Flowers, I miss Uppy texting us on a fucking Sunday or Monday being like, what are you guys doing? We're like, we're not fucking moving, I'm sure.
Leave us the fuck alone, I'm sure.
We got four movies, Rocky fucking 2, 4, and then we're going with Top Gun after that. We're not going anywhere.
What's the best Rocky movie, Flowers?
The best Rocky movie is...
Give us a Rocky impression.
Rocky 1's the best movie of all time.
I thought you said Rocky 5 was.
Rocky 1 is the greatest movie of all time. Khan's who took off.
Khan's is gone.
Khan's is gone.
I think he's trying to sell the building up front. I think he's done. I think he's done. I think I heard him.
I think hey, I affected
Give me the Rocky Cut Me Mick. You know what makes me laugh every time we're drunk as a skunk at night? Give me the Cut Me Mick.
Cut Me Mick. Cut Me. You don't want to do it. Cut Me.
Anyways,
I could do Rocky lines all day long.
What's your favorite movie of all time?
Rocky 1's my favorite movie of all time, without a doubt. I'm a big movie guy.
Second,
Forrest Gump, Good Will Hunting, Saving Private Ryan, Gladiator. And that's
listen,
that's my top
what
five.
Was the stupid last thing before we let you go? And Flowers, listen, you're welcome anytime, brother.
Yeah.
We love having you in here. You're a friend of the show. What was that stupid fucking movie you made me want? Trying to make Pacific Rim or something?
It wasn't bad. It was a Sunday hungover
movie. I
like movie.
A Pacific Rim job.
Anyways, Flowers, we love you. You're welcome anytime. Larry Flowers, Drew, check it out. Up Dog, you're the man. Khan's, I think, went to the Ivy for lunch or something because he's gone. But listeners, thank you very much. Larry Flowers.
Who the fuck is Larry Flowers?
Flowers.